Hello, everyone. Welcome to South Africa via Williamson County Public Library. And thank you for taking your time today to come out and visit us here at the library and visit South Africa. If there is further information that you would like to know, we have some books over here that can be checked out. We also have some online resources that would help you find further information, some that even Google can't get you in, so that's always good. We are very excited today. We've got some great food in the back, so help yourself. And I think I'm going to hand it over to Sarah with Sister Cities, and thanks again for coming.
Thank you. Thank you, Dolores. And thank you to the Williamson County Public Library that supports this program, which is called Passport to the World. And it's run through Sister Cities of Franklin and Williamson County. We do these every couple of months with different countries. And the amount of pride that people have in their countries is just remarkable and wonderful. And part of the reason we do this is to show that, to introduce sort of the diverse community we actually have here, which is part of the part of what Sister Cities does. In addition to what Sister Cities does. Wait, let me just go through real quick for those of you who don't know Sister Cities. I can do this. Okay, so Sister Cities has a mission of building global relationships and sharing cultural and educational experiences and inspiring economic growth. Some of the ways we do this are through student exchanges. We have three Sister Cities. Franklin has three sister cities. None of them are South African cities, unfortunately. We have a German sister city, Bad Soden, and a Irish sister city in Ireland. Oh, hello, the Irish contingent is back there, County Leash. And it's a county, not a city. And then Canada, Carleton Place, Canada. So we do student exchanges with Carleton Place and with Bad Soden, high school students. It's wonderful. They're here. They come back. Are they here now?
They arrive Friday.
They will arrive Friday. So they do house exchange. You know, they stay in our homes, and then our kids go and stay at their homes. Lifetime friendships happen this way. It's beautiful. And then some of the other things we do, oh, you can see the Great Pumpkin. Has anybody ever been to our Oktoberfest on Main Street? Pumpkin Fest on Main Street. We supply the pumpkin from our sister city. They grow it in Canada, and they drive it all the way down here to plop in the middle of Main Street. So isn't that that's kind of cool. And then, and Celebration of Nations, we have a big music festival. So this is all to, bring people together, build bridges through our community. Let's see what else we got. Okay, so we have some tentative passports coming up with Mexico in March and Hawaii in May. But in between, we have an adult exchange from some of the adults in Germany, in Bad Soden, are coming. They're musicians, and they're coming, and they're going to be performing with some local musicians here and hanging out with the locals. And they're going to be doing some gigs at a house concert in Leaper's Fork and Kimbrough's performance. And if you want any information about Sister Cities, very easy to find us. There are some really nice, this is a library, so we have bookmarks in the back table there. Everyone take a bookmark and before you leave. But I also want to introduce this wonderful group of Sister Cities board members and volunteers who are back here. Stand up or say hello or wave. Yay! And if you have any questions about anything I just mentioned, or if you want to volunteer for Sister Cities or anything like that, just speak to one of them or speak to me. I'm Sarah Light. Is that all I want to say about Sister Cities? Let's see. Yes, okay. All right. Let's go. That's what Simba, is that what it means? Yeah. I'm learning my Xhosa language. No, I don't know how to pronounce it. Xhosa. Okay. So before we move on to our program, I just want to do some more thank yous, because if you noticed, the back table has lots and lots of South African food. That didn't happen magically. That happened because we have some wonderful people who decided that they were going to help make this a true cultural event, and they... Yes. And they have volunteered to do this. So the first person I want to thank is not here, unfortunately. She couldn't be here. Is a woman named Kobe Pretorius. And she runs the Friends of South Africa, who apparently have a 500-person mailing list. Did we know that there were that many South Africans? I didn't. Here in this area. So she sent an email to everybody to let us know. She helped us organize. And I think that flag back there is from her. And Nazreen picked it up. Thank you. So speaking of Nazreen Dahals, raise your hand. If you try the beautiful samosas back there, handmade. Thank you very much. And then Nanette O'Grady, who couldn't be here either, but she sent the rusks, and they are like the little biscottis. Thank you. They're like biscottis, which is, you know, and they apparently are very good dipped in coffee. Or tea. Speaking of which, we have some coffee back there, and we have two kinds of tea. One of them is a South African tea that was from, I actually got it as a gift from my niece who had studied in South Africa, and so I made it for today. And then we also want to thank, Andrea. There you are. No, where's Andrea? That's Sarah. Oh, there's Andrea. Andrea is new in town, a new South African, hello, family. And her beautiful daughter, Kayla, and her husband, Ryan. So say hello to our new South African Franklinites. Say hi. What's your name? Shanae, thank you for coming today. And I wanted to say that the Barfield family brought malva pudding. That's back there. And you also brought some of those milk tarts, too. So way to ingratiate yourself to the town through the food. And then we also have biltong, just in case you were wondering. And that is from, of course, the carnivore market in the factory. How many of you have ever been to carnivore? No. Yeah, that's what it's called, right? Carnivore. Yeah. Meat. A lot of people have been. So they have amazing meat in general, but also some South African foods in particular. So we have a sampling of that back there, too. Yes, hopefully it won't all be gone by the time I see people going. And let's see, I think that is all with that so far. And then, okay, so we're ready to start our official presentation, which is going to start first with a song. And the song is... Everybody say it together. Siahamba. Siahamba. And we're bringing up Sarah Bonsignor. Am I pronouncing that correctly? Please come in. And Sarah's beautiful, wonderful, amazing boys, and who are named Sean, Thomas, and Aiden Hemstock. Yes. And they are going to come up right here. Come here, boys. And I'm going to, we're going to take a video of them. Somebody take a picture, video picture. Okay. I'm going to hand it to Sarah.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sarah. I grew up in Durban, South Africa. Anyone from Durban? Yes. And I taught this to my kids, and we usually sing it around the dinner table, so we will do our best. Siyahamba means we are marching. So Siyahamba and Kukanyen Kwenkos means
we are marching in the light of God.
Yes.
Siyahambe kukanyen kwenkos, siyahambe kukanyen kwenkos, siyahambe kukanyen kwenkos, siyahambe kukanyen kwenkos, siyahamba, hamba siyahamba, hamba siyahambe kukanyen kwenkos, siyahamba. Hamba siya hamba, hamba siya hambe kukanyene kwenkos. Siya hambe kukanyene kwenkos, siya hambe kukanyene kwenkos. Siya hambe kukanyene kwenkos, siya hambe kukanyene kwenkos. Siya hamba. Hamba siya hamba, hamba siya hambe kukanyene kwenkos. Siya hamba, hamba siya hamba, hamba siya hambe kukanyene kwenkos.
Anyone else? No, Siyahamba? It's the language of, I actually thought it was in Zulu, but I guess, what is in Zulu we are marching? Hamba?
Siyahamba is
Zulu.
Oh,
yeah.
Is Zulu?
So when I saw Koza, I was like, maybe I don't know the song, but I think it's in Zulu. But there are, no, it's fine. There are many national languages in South Africa, and most people speak English, Afrikaans, and Zulu. And then I think there are 12, right? Maybe you'll talk about that.
Yeah.
But music is an integral part of the country, and I think it's where you find the heart of the country and the music. And I actually taught in New York for 20 years, and I would always teach South African songs, and I thought they were the most fun. So, I mean, I did everything, but yeah. So thank you for listening.
It's amazing that they did this, but also, in fact, there are special certificates for each one of those boys that is thanking them for helping Sister Cities
thank
with this.
So
thank you very much. All right. Okay. Now, we are up to our next portion. Now, I'm bringing up, come on up here, Renee. All right. This is my friend Renee. Hold on. I'm going to come around here. Okay. Renee Sylvie is going to be our main speaker today. She's going to help us talk about, South Africa, talk a little bit about the history, the geography, the culture, so educate us a little bit, although, you know, for those of you who aren't from South Africa here, but I want to ask you first, say hi, Renee.
Hello.
Renee also lives in the same apartment buildings as my mom, who's there, and our friend Midge, who's in the senior apartments, so in Summerby. So shout out to Summerby. So Renee, I wanted you to tell us a little bit first about sort of where you grew up and how you got here a little bit. Yeah, talk a little bit about yourself.
Okay. Well, I grew up in a little town called Ceres, down about 80 miles north of Cape Town. Beautiful. It was a fruit farmer's haven. And my father was a businessman in town, but we had also lived on a small farm just outside, and it was called Tall Timbers. And it was a little fruit farm. peaches, pears, and plums, and it was just a beautiful, beautiful area. I was very fortunate to have grown up in that. And then I went to a boarding school at Stellenbosch, which was the second oldest town in South Africa. Cape Town was the oldest, and then Stellenbosch. I went to boarding school to learn to speak fluent English. That was a very important thing with my dad. You've got to be able to speak Afrikaans and English both fluently. So, can you hear? Okay. So, then I went to university, same town, University of Stellenbosch, where I got my bachelor's degree in dietetics and physiology, of dieetkunde en fysiologie, if any of you understand Afrikaans. That is where I spent 4 years. And then one of our teachers suggested that we come over to the United States and do a dietetic internship at a hospital. So I did that. And during that time that I was here, I stayed a little while longer and met my husband. And he was from northern Iowa, Cedar Falls, Iowa. Anybody else from Iowa? No? Wonderful, wonderful people. They're so warm up there in the heart of America. And so there, I was at the University of Iowa at the internship program, and I met several others from all over the world, actually, in that internship program. That was very, very interesting. And as I said, yeah, I met my husband, and I was doing a thesis and for a master's, and I had to work in the library in the evenings. So he would come and sit with his medical books and sit in the, it was a small office next to the lab up there where I had to work and study while I was doing pouring this and that, this and other, writing down to see what it all came up to. And so that was, and then eventually when I said to my dad, or wrote to him or called him and said we wanted to get married, he said, "You come home right away and we'll talk about this." So I went home right away and we talked about it. And Marv had 2 more years of medical school to finish, and I was very fortunate that I found a position over there at the Children's Red Cross Boer Memorial Hospital. It was for children up to the age of 12, and that's a whole nother story. I cannot go into that, but it was fascinating. So then there I was, and he came once, and he came to visit and to meet my family and to ask my dad for my hand in marriage. My husband had grown up in a teetotaler family. And good Baptist teetotaler family. Now, my mother had grown up on a wine farm. And they were definitely not teetotalers, let me just put it that way. So that evening when Marv went into my dad's study to go talk about this, Dad poured them each a stiff scotch. And afterwards, Marv said to me, "I do not remember a single word of what was said in there." He didn't remain a teetotaler. So anyhow, he came back again about a year later, and we got married there down in Cape Town at the old Mother Church of the Dutch Reformed Church, the old Moederkerk. And that was quite an experience. Beautiful old historic building. And our preacher did speak in English, except he said he could not pray because he did not understand about the thee and the thou. So he prayed in Afrikaans. Anyhow, so then we came back. And Marv had to start his internship, and I had to start a position at Phoenix at St. Joseph's Hospital. And so we were going down there, and we were driving down there. And on the way down there, we were to meet his grandmother and aunt, Aunt Hazel and Granny. And I got down there, but nobody had thought to tell them that I was a white South African. So they were expecting Marv to turn up with this little black South African girl. And so they were a little nervous about all of this, didn't know how it's going to go. So I got there and they saw me and they were just elated. And not because of the way I looked, but well, because I was white. And I hope this doesn't bother anybody when I say black or white. It's just, I used to speak that way. But And there they were. And they were just very happy to see me. And I could have done somersaults over the breakfast table the next day because they were so happy of my race, if I can put it that way. And then we went on to Phoenix, and we were there for a year. After that, 2 years in the Air Force. And after that, back to Iowa for a residency, my husband's residency in radiology. And after that, by that time, we had two children. One of them is sitting back there. Janine, put your hand up. and also our son, who is still in Arizona, our son Brian, and his family. They're over there. And I went to South Africa about last year, end of April, beginning of May. And it was just wonderful seeing all the cousins. My goodness, I have a lot of them. And it was just a joyful reunion with all of them. And we are still, I don't know if any of you are familiar with WhatsApp. WhatsApping backwards and forwards, all sorts of family history and so on. And it was a great meeting and get together, two family reunions. Then we stayed. Yeah, for 44 years we lived in Phoenix because, Marv joined a practice down there, East Valley Diagnostic Imaging, and it was large, and we were there for a long, long time, and we loved it, and that place, to live in Arizona is entirely different than it is to live here in in this beautiful, beautiful Tennessee, Franklin area that we are. Because, of course, it's semi-desert over there, right? And it gets terribly hot, a different kind of hot, but still very hot, to the point that you can't touch your car's, the handle when you open the door. Very hot. And the reason why we are here is because my husband, he became ill. He developed Alzheimer's disease. And so our children decided it's probably the best for us to come somewhere where we are going to be well looked after. And Janine and her family had seen Summerby going up, Summerby of Franklin. It's a wonderful retirement center in Franklin. And they saw it come up, so we came and looked at it and decided this will be a good place for us. And then after that, we went back home and we had to pack up 44 years worth of belongings in the same house. And so there was just a lot over there. And we came over here, and it's just been a wonderful place. My husband passed away in the end of 2018. And so I'm there by myself, but I have a whole family worth of wonderful people. Some of them are over here, and it's just good to know that they're here. And, it's a great place to stay. So further on, let's go back to South Africa. That's enough of me.
Can I help you for 1 second? Because would it help you to not have to hold this?
Okay.
I don't know if that'll...
Okay. Would that, just... can you hear me now?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
And then, there we go.
Okay. Well, here is the... I have to show you. This is actually pure ivory. And it was not, you hear about ivory being elephants being killed so people can get ivory. This was before those days. When I was 4 years old, my parents went to Rhodesia, and this came from there. But it's a wonderful pointer. So here it goes. It's just huge, right? Just absolutely huge. South Africa is just right over here, way down in the south. So I say that because it's back there. I say that because so often people hear I'm from Africa and they want to know, are you near to Kenya? No, where's Kenya? Way up here, right? Or Uganda, which is right next door. Or the Congo, or wherever, Egypt. Who knows? They don't understand the enormousness of this huge continent. And so I just need to usually tell them it's South Africa, which means it's way down in the south, right? Okay, so Then, if we can have the South Africa, there's South Africa. Now, these are the provinces, the areas that are now in South Africa. Western Cape, Cape Town is over here. And Ceres, where I grew up, is about here. Stellenbosch, where I went to school, is about here. The Northern Cape is essentially dry, semi-desert, like in Ajo, Arizona. You've been very dry. Sheep love it. They love, I don't know if they eat the rock or what, but they love it. This is the Eastern Cape. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful area. And then this area from here to here, which is, it's just a magnificent area to look at. It's just beautiful. Beaches and rocks and sort of just green. And okay, so I can't leave out Johannesburg, can I? Whew.
Oh wait, oh here, if you wanna see some pictures.
Okay.
Here.
Okay.
There's Cape Town.
That's Table Mountain. And I'll tell you about Table Mountain.
You want to do that now?
Or? Okay, yeah, I can do it now.
Up to you.
Table Mountain. Table Mountain is just magnificent. As a matter of fact, a few years ago, it was chosen by the Swiss-based New Seven Wonders Foundation competition, and it is one of the natural wonders in the world. The Amazon River is one of them, and several others. But Cape Town, the Table Mountain, was selected. So everybody was very excited about that. You can see the harbor in the front. And you can see behind the table, there's some more mountains going back there, kind of T-shaped. And it's a beautiful reserve area back there called Cape Point. Okay, so. Yeah, okay. Now, we have Cape Town out here in Eastern Province. Now, Lesotho and Swaziland are two small little countries separate from South Africa, but they are in there. Gauteng up here is where Johannesburg and Pretoria are. And right here, about here, is a place called Kimberley that I'll tell you about in just a minute. Okay. I think that's that for now. Stellenbosch is a town that's about, like I told you where it was, right down near to Cape Town. That's where I went to boarding school and to university, as I said before. And it's wine country. Gorgeous, gorgeous, beautiful wine country. The mountains in South Africa are just amazing. They are absolutely, they're just amazing. You can't, we have wonderful mountains here too, don't we? Not here, not in this area, but if you go west, and northeast, and if you go to the Smokies, gorgeous mountains. But I grew up with those mountains, South Africa, loved them. And Johannesburg, why don't I start with Johannesburg? We've got the wine country in Stellenbosch, and then Ceres, where I grew up, and then Johannesburg up there is a large metropolitan city. There you have mining and financial activity and industry going on at a major scale. It's just, it's very much, part of it is very much first world. Then there's also part of it that's more third world. And that you'll find in South Africa, wherever you go, that you still have, even though things have changed lately, you still have this this thing where you have the white population is still living at a higher standard of living than the people that are not of non-white folks. And this is changing, I'm happy to say. It's changing very definitely. And everybody is making a big effort to make it all work. And Johannesburg is the mining country. And we were there when my children were small. And Janine, do you remember that, Janine? We went into that gold mine way down in there. And I think they told us to open our mouth when they were blasting. That had something to do with protecting your ears. Yes. And we came out of there, and each of the children got a piece of solid gold about the size of a pound of butter to hold, and had their pictures taken. And of course, we had our hard hats on and things like that. It was a very interesting, very, very interesting experience. And then that's gold. There are other places where gold is mined as well, but that's the major area. Then right in the middle, right in the middle, there's a place called Kimberley. And Kimberley is also a big diamond place. That is where the big hole, the Kimberley big hole, diamond hole is right there. It started out as a little hill. And people found diamonds there, and people from all over the world came and dug for diamonds, and the little hill disappeared. And then they went down and mined the diamonds out of this huge hole. And it's still there. I don't believe that mine is still open or still being used. I think it's been mined out. Also, there's some water in the bottom of the hole. But the diamonds in South Africa, if any of you have a diamond, it's probably from there. I can't promise you that because Australia and other countries also have diamonds. But some of the most beautiful diamonds are actually found further north along the west coast, just south of Namibia, into Namibia, that whole area there. And I've been to that mine as well. That was fascinating. There they had a Siemens machine, huge, that would suck up the sand from the beach and deliver it over there so they could get down to bedrock. And right down there at bedrock, they'll have the workers, who are very carefully chosen, I'd like you to know, they have their little whisk brooms, and they'll go, the bedrock is almost like the brain, you know, like that. And they'll go into those hollows and whisk until they see a diamond. And they are found, but they are watched very, very carefully. That was fascinating. We saw how it's prepared to be shipped overseas. And I have a cousin whose job is, with one of the mines, he would take the rough diamonds to Europe, you know, to be polished and so on and so forth. And he still does that to this day, my cousin Joss. And so those are the important things, money-wise, that's exported from South Africa. There are also some other minerals that are exported. Where are they now? I've got a whole list of them. Anyhow, iron ore is one of them, and coal is one of them, and various different manganese and so on, and they go out, and as part of what's comes in. What else is exported other than the minerals? Wool is one of the big exports. I have a brother who's a big wool farmer, Merino, stud Merino sheep, and then wool is one, and then different kinds of grains. And grains and the wool and wine. Oh yeah, wine and South African wines, along with the rest of the world, they do very well. They compare very well. They've won several great awards and so forth. So that's what South Africa exports, and that's what's gained there. Farming again, much along the same lines. The same brother of mine also farms with, wheat and canola and barley for the breweries and so on. So they, they're big farmers over there. There are some problems in the northern part of South Africa where there have been farmers that have been shot by some of their workers. And this has happened to a friend of mine. Her father was shot. There, as you can imagine, and I'll come to apartheid in just a minute, but there were a lot of angry feelings amongst the non-white population because of the apartheid that had started. Now, apartheid was something that started around about 1948. Actually, it started long before then. Long before then, it started, and it was something that, you know, the white community was on one side, and the non-whites were the other side, and they, and we just, I grew up with it. It was just sort of the way things were. They weren't right, but it was that way. Finally, the church, Dutch Reformed Church, said something's very wrong here. Something needs to be done. And changes came about. And there were three very important men in South African history. The one was Nelson Mandela. And I'm sure all of you have heard of this wonderful man, Nelson Mandela. Yeah, he had been incarcerated because he had been part of an uprising way up in the Johannesburg area years and years before, and it was a big uprising. And so he was put in prison down here. There's a little island here off of Cape Town. There's a small island, and it's called Robben Island or Seal Island. And that's where he stayed for 17 years, doing hard labor. And anyhow, so there was this other man who was Mr. Botha, or Botha, B-O-T-H-A. And Mr. Botha was prime minister and realized things have to change and started some of the changes. And after him came President de Klerk, or de Klerk, rather, was the way it was pronounced. And Mr. de Klerk was very much... realized this had to happen. And so Nelson Mandela came out of prison in 1990. And he and Mr. de Klerk and Mr. Botha and many others worked together to find a peaceable solution for the future of South Africa. And that is exactly what they did. So in 1994, everybody above the age of 18 in South Africa, could have been 21, I'm not sure, could vote. For the first time ever. And that was a huge time of celebration in South Africa. You can just imagine. Now, of course, there were problems that came after that. As you can imagine, there was a lot of adjustments that had to be made. And they were made and are still being made. And there's also some crime there, that so that if you ever want to travel, and it's a beautiful country to travel, if I may say so, go with a good touring, you know, a touring company. Take a tour, and it's there are many different companies that have tours through South Africa, and that you'll be safe on a tour. You'll be just good. It's just good to know that. So I'll mention that. And where I've gone, I've never had a problem with crime because I go to family. You know, the one family member will see I get to the other one, or I take the bus to the other one, so on and so forth. And my last time, my brother drove me everywhere I needed to go. Can everybody still hear? Yes. Is everybody still awake? Yes. Okay. Let's just think about South Africa. Let's go back. The Dutch owned the Spice Islands. The Dutch were way up there, right? And they owned the Spice Islands across the Indian Ocean, way over here on this side. And that would be Batavia, Malaya, Indonesia, that area. And they would send their ships all the way around the bottom part of Africa to go across the Indian Ocean to the Spice Islands, which, of course, the spices were then distributed through Europe. However, they had a problem. The sailors were dying. Can anybody guess what they were dying from? Scurvy, that's right, scurvy. They didn't have enough vitamin C, they didn't have enough fruits, vegetables, etc. And so they decided they need a garden. And the best place for it would be right down there in the south, where Cape Town is today. And three little ships came in 1652. And the first people they met were the Hottentots and the Bushmen, who were little nomadic tribes. And I think that they provided the Dutchman with meat, and I'm sure the Dutchman gave them something else that was shiny, you know, that they'd never seen before in place. And then after the Dutch came the French. And on my mother's side, I'm from French extraction. De Villiers was her last name. And they were from the French Huguenots. Have you all heard about the French Huguenots? Yeah, they fled for their religion in France and came down. And many of them came. There's still many, many last names in South Africa, and first names, like my own, in South Africa, that came from the French Huguenots. And then some German people infiltrated, and people from other parts of the country, Portugal, other people, other places, other countries. And then, I've lost it. Let me have a look.
Look, here, look, I put a time on for you.
Oh, there's a time.
Does that help?
Yes, that would help. Thank you. Okay. Then as we can see over here, the British settlers came in, oh, I think you can see on the red, yeah, 1820. And then the ANC, African National Conference, was started. And that was the black communities wanting to have their say and their part in South Africa. And Nelson Mandela was part of the ANC, very much so. And then Nelson was released, and I can't see what it says. Let me work around this way. Okay. Yeah, he was released from prison, and as I said, they all worked together, and we've gone through that. And then he was awarded Nobel Peace Prize, very fittingly, beautifully, in 1993. And in 1994, that was when everybody could vote, as I said. Now, the Soccer Cup, World Soccer Cup, was there. Oh, my goodness. All the airports were being renewed and redone and everything, because people from all over the world were coming in. That was a big, big thing, that Soccer Cup. And it was played in various places in South Africa. And then something else is... Are any of you familiar with rugby?
Yes.
Yes? Well, this, every 4 years, there's a rugby tournament in Japan. And from all the countries in the world, which will be France, and England, Australia, the Argentine, Australia, New Zealand, and so on and so forth, they all play rugby. So there's this huge tournament, and do you know who won this past year? Yeah, South Africa played against England, the Springboks, they were called Springboks, South African Springboks played against the English Lions, and they won. They won. Oh, this was big stuff. So that was that's something, those two events, sort of international events, and they were important to the South Africans and the other people that you know, that competed as well, I'm sure. And so we did have a war in South Africa. I wonder if any of you can guess who and why. Okay, the English knew and had heard about all these wonderful diamonds and the gold especially. And as England did, they wanted to go in and get it, right? So they did come down, and there was this war called the Anglo-Boer War. Now, I want to tell you about the word Boer. It's pronounced Boer in Afrikaans, and it means farmer. So it was the British Empire against the South African farmers. But the farmers wanted to keep their gold and their country, and they didn't want to be submitted under England, and they've had experience of that in the past. They didn't want that again. So they came. They came in their big red coats, you know, and they had their regiments set out. The British, they did the original kind of war, you know. You big whole section of them, and they'll shoot and hope that the others would and expect the others to shoot back, and then you'll have this war between these two, you know. Didn't quite happen that way. The Afrikaans people, or the farmers, had so few in comparison with the British that they used guerrilla warfare. And they were on their horses, and they knew the area, and they knew the little hills. There were little hills and bushes and little rivers or whatever. They knew where to hide. So there was the British with all their red coats, and they didn't have anybody to shoot at. My gracious, what kind of war is that? They were quite upset. However, as more and more of the British came in, somebody else came in, and I'm sure you all know his name, and that was Winston Churchill. He was a young man. He was a war correspondent for the British, and he was caught in Pretoria, near to Johannesburg, and he was in prison there, and he tried to escape, and he did escape. Somehow or another, he escaped. His friend that was supposed to escape with him couldn't make it, but he did by himself. And so at night, mostly, I just read the book just recently, he traveled eastward because he knew he had to get to Mozambique to get out of South Africa because he was in mortal danger in South Africa. So he traveled, and one night he was absolutely destitute. He was thirsty, he was hungry, he was exhausted. And it was at night, and there were some little lights shining. And he thought, you know, if that's an Afrikaans family, I'm done. But he went, and it was a small coal mine. And there were some English-speaking residents there, or the people that ran the mine. And they said, well, they're looking for you. We'll put you down the mine shaft. So they put Winston-Salem down the mine shaft. And in and about and whatever, you know, to hide him down there with a blanket and some water and something to eat. So he was there for several days. Can you imagine? A coal. You know how dirty that is? Anyhow. So finally they said, you know, we've got to get you out of there. They're coming closer. They're looking for you. So they had another English farmer. It was a wool farmer. And he would send his wool to Lorenzo Marx in Mozambique. And so what they did is they kind of rolled him up. I don't know if they rolled him up in a bale of wool or put him in amongst some wool bales, however they did it. And he had a little area to breathe and probably gave him some biscuit, some biscotti from like over there or something to gnaw on or chew on. And he got to Mozambique safely. And when he got there, he went to the British officers over there. And they said, no, he can't come in. He can't come in because he was so pitch black and dirty. And then he said, well, he was actually the son of Lord Randolph Churchill. And he needs to get back there. And so they cleaned him up and got him a new suit, I believe. And up he went to England. Now, let's get back to South Africa. But just think, Winston Churchill, what if they had caught him? And what if he was hung over there, which is what they did with political prisoners? What would have happened during the Second World War? So, God is in control in wonderful ways. This is my pointer. And further, time-wise, how are we doing? I will talk about the capitals. Yeah. There are actually three capitals. The one is in Cape Town. That's the legislative capital. One is in Pretoria. Well, they make the laws down in Cape Town. I don't know what they do up in Pretoria, and they do something else in Bloemfontein. But those are the three capitals. They all work together somehow. And... yeah, there's Bloemfontein where the big hole was that I told you about, the diamond mines, and then Pretoria, Johannesburg, way up there, as that's about close to 1,000 miles between Cape Town and Johannesburg and Pretoria. And then Durban is over here, and Natal, KwaZulu-Natal is that area, it's called over there. These are all port cities. And Durban is a huge, huge port city. Lots of exports. Maybe I've said that before. But it was those cities that are that I've mentioned before. Those are what South Africa needs to run, you know. And so that is good. Now I want to tell you, because I know you've all been waiting for news about the animals, right? Oh yes. Now when I come, I can't remember if I told you this before. When people hear I'm from South Africa, they want to hear, are there animals all over the place? Like wild animals. So I said, well, we have animals. We have sheep and cats and dogs. But wild animals, no. They're not just running around. There are huge, huge and beautiful facilities for them. They are the Kruger National Park is the biggest one and probably the most well-known one. It's way up here.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
Pictures of where's
Kruger? Kruger, oops, go back.
There is.
Yeah, Kruger would be about here, over there, way up there. It's just, oh my goodness, I can't tell you how wonderful it is to go through Kruger Park. First of all, you can't just... you have to make reservations to get in, because people from all over the world want to be there. And they want to see these animals that are so well known. There are what they call the Big Five. And the Big Five are lion and leopard, elephant, hippos, and the Cape buffaloes. And there are others as well that we all know and love. For instance, that's my little painting over there, I didn't do it, of the giraffe, but they're not dangerous. The power animals are the ones I just mentioned to you. And you will see those in the Kruger National Park. And 6-foot fences all the way around. You have to be in by 6 p.m., I believe, at night. There are restaurants in these. There are several little towns in the park and where you can stay. And they have these little, they're not huts, they're called rondavels, which is a little round building with a thatched roof, like that. And they are wonderful. They have everything you need in those areas, your bathrooms, everything. It's just a wonderful place to stay. They now have really opened it for families, so children can ride elephants and so on and so forth. I can't imagine that I would have put my children on an elephant. Nevertheless, they do that now, and I'm sure it's quite safe. And you see these animals, and you drive by day, no guns at all allowed, as you can imagine. It's just for viewing. And you can see, I remember once, Janine, you may remember this, when we were there with our grandfather, Sylvie was with us, and it was raining. And as we, just before we went out, there was this huge lion, and he got up and he shook his head and his mane, and water flew in all directions. And the camera wasn't quite ready, you know, unfortunately, but it's something I'll never forget. Do you remember that, Neen? Maybe?
I was seven, I don't remember.
No. Yeah. Anyhow, you see the lions, you see the elephants. Now, an elephant may come and stand in front of your car on a road, and the roads are not tarred. They are, you know, as natural as can possibly be. And you just wait. You don't do anything. You don't go around the elephant off the road. You just wait, and pretty soon there'll be several other cars behind you, and everybody has their cameras going and everything, and maybe eventually the elephant would find itself go off in a different direction. And they do, eventually. and so there are, okay, can anybody guess what animal has caused the most deaths in Africa, all of Africa?
Hippo.
Hippo, right, the hippo has. And because so many people have in all over Africa have to go down to streams to get their water. Might not be clean water, but it's water. And also a hippo can live in the water as well as can walk on the land. So there are some areas where they actually will come into the little town, St. Lucia, I believe, along the east coast, where they actually will come and go through town at night to see if there's something they could eat. And then another very, very dangerous animal is the Cape buffalo. Cape buffalo have those big, do we have any animal photos? Maybe not, but just the others. Kruger National Park, here your elephants are. You can see how near they can be to the car. And there's your cheetah over there, and your that's actually a leopard over there.
The one in the middle.
That's a Cape buffalo. No? No, that's a wildebeest. I'm sorry. That's a wildebeest. Right. Okay. And thank you.
Yeah,
no, you wouldn't quite be there. No, you wouldn't want to be there. Did I already? I rehearsed this several times, and I can't remember what I've rehearsed and what I've taught you or told you. Did I tell you the story about the pup tent?
No.
Okay, I had a cousin and her husband, and they went camping up there close to the Kruger Park. But they decided they were going to rough it. They weren't going to go into the park. Heavens knows. There are restaurants there and everything else. No, they had this little pup tent, and they camped out somewhere. And early morning, they heard this, on his side of the tent. And then a little bit more of the same sound. And pretty soon, there was a, on her side of the tent. And these two animals, obviously lions, were talking to one another across the tent. They were communicating. And the two people inside were just terrified, as you can just imagine. And so it was early morning, and would you believe that her little alarm clock went off? Ooh, there was a scramble in the dark because she couldn't remember which bag she'd put the alarm clock in. So they were looking for the alarm clock, finally found it, turned it off, and there was quiet on both sides. So that tiny little alarm clock had scared away these two big lions. Yeah, and so the elephants and the lions and the Cape buffalo and the what was the other one you mentioned? The wildebeest, yes. They are dangerous, and you don't want to particularly. Now, the rhinoceros is another one. And I had a brother who did a lot of big game hunting. Well, not big game hunting, but hunting. And he was chased by a rhinoceros. They have very poor sight, but their hearing is very, very good. And he was running along a little higher edge, and the rhinoceros was lower down, and they were both running. But he got to the truck before the rhinoceros did. And the rhinoceros stopped. And next day, it was in a newspaper down in Cape Town. Little things like that, you know, it's kind of exciting news and so on. So these animals are treasures of South Africa. And it's so, so sad to know that elephants and hippos are being hunted for their horns and for the ivory. So many of those elephants have been killed by poachers that come in. And this is one of the sad things to try and maintain the elephant population over there. And the same with rhinoceros. The horn of the rhinoceros is very valuable in places like China and in the Orient, in the East. And so there are so many people that are trained to look out for these poachers so that they can, by radio, let somebody know they're there and get them out or catch them or whatever. Well, this is really essentially, let me see if there's anything else about South Africa. Oh, yes, the Bantu tribes. I've got to talk about them. Because as the whites from the bottom of South Africa moved up through the years, and they even had a big trek east to get out from underneath British rule, east and also north to Johannesburg, there were these different Bantu tribes that they came in contact with. And there was the Zulu that we talked about before, and the Khoza, and Mandela was a Khoza, and Basutu, Bapedi, Venda, Tswana, Tswanga, Tswazi, and Ndebele tribes. So there are a lot of tribes, probably more than that as well. And so, of course, there are many languages, as Nazreen mentioned, many languages. And hard languages. They don't look like English or Afrikaans or Dutch or German. Long words that are very difficult to learn to speak and pronounce and to know what it means. And farmer children that grew up with young African children very often picked up these languages, and so they knew them. And they were. I don't know if I should tell the story. It's the last story. My brother went to a school called St. Andrew's College. It was a high school, a college, prep college, and he had some friends there. And one of his friends, later on, a generation later on, was a farmer, and he had some African folks working on his farm. But there was one little boy was just very special with the little white boy. You know, the two of them were just big friends. And so finally the father said to the little white boy, "Well, you're going to St. Andrews?" And he said, "I'm not going if Klonky's not going. Klonky's got to go." And so Klonky went to St. Andrews. They made it special because he had not had the high school education or the junior high education that Johnny had. And so he went. And he did wonderfully there. They especially made an effort to bring him up to where he should be, and later on became a businessman and just did wonderfully there. And so my brother felt very good about his school that could do that, his old alma mater school that could do that. And that's about the end of my story about South Africa. Does anybody have any questions?
Could you talk about your experience going to boarding school, which I know is very common?
Yes. Yes.
How old were you when you went to boarding school, and what was that experience
for you? Well, very interesting question. Many of the rural South African children went to boarding school. Now, our towns had a boarding house where you could go to school, to go to the high school over there. But many felt that perhaps their children could get a better education closer to the city. And that's why I went to Rhenish Girls High School. Rhenish means from the Rhine, because the old German missionaries had a school for their sons, but not for their daughters. So Rhenish Rhine, that was where that was named after. But in my case, my mother passed away when I was 15. And so my sister had also passed away that year. So it was a very difficult year for our family. And my dad just felt I needed to get out of that house and amongst some young people, my own age, and learn to speak English at the same time, which I did. And I went there, and it was a wonderful experience for me. I had just such a wonderful friend. Her parents had been from England, so she helped me with my math, and I helped her with her Afrikaans. And so between the two of us, we both passed in the end. And yeah, I enjoyed it very, very much. It was an all-girls school, and yeah. Does that answer your question? Okay, any other questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
In modern-day South Africa, with all the influences that you have, if we were going to go visit, is there some definite do's or do-nots, or for example, when you go to France, people kiss you on both cheeks?
Well, your Afrikaans people may kiss you on the mouth.
They kiss you on the mouth?
Maybe. The older ones will do that. But the younger ones know much better than that. So really, there isn't anything specifically except that you must stay safe. You must stay safe. And that is not a problem, so long as you go with a traveling company.
And what about holidays? Are there any, special South African holidays that we don't celebrate here?
Yes, there is a Freedom Day for the day that Nelson Mandela came out of prison. That is a Freedom Day. I don't know, I'm not quite sure that's the name of it, but they have a name for that. And then on the 16th of November, I believe they have some kind of a holiday as well that celebrated something, whether it was from a Boer War or from some other war, whatever. But on the whole, the same kind of things as here. Yeah. Yes, Mitch?
Dangers that you're trying to avoid?
It's just general crime. You can understand that there is a difference between the income of the white population to this day and most, not all, but most of the non-white population. And when you have that difference, there's always a possibility of people wanting to steal your cell phone. That's a big thing that can be stolen. And you might be hurt in the process, I don't know. And your car might be towed. At a stoplight, they might force you out of your car, get in and drive off. That's the kind of things that you want to avoid.
And also hippos.
Right. Okay. Any other questions? Janine, you have something to say? Oh, there's a question back there.
Are Cape Town, Johannesburg, and other large cities very international population-based?
Yes.
Like from big population from India or other?
Yes. Yes.
Milled in?
Okay, you want to answer?
Can I answer that question?
Please.
Okay, so in 1860, the British wanted the African people to work for them and toil the soil. And the African people refused to do that because they said, this is our land, we do not want to work for the British. So the British went to India and they said to the Indians, we have very fertile soil in KwaZulu-Natal, which is on the East Coast. We want you to come and toil the soil. And when you've done that, you have a choice to either stay there or go back to India. So in 1860, they put 342 people on a ship, two ships, the Truro and the Dromedary, and they brought them from India to South Africa. Today, the population of Indians in South Africa is 1.3 million. Yes. So if you look at the demographics of South Africa, 79% is African. So it's made up of the different African tribes and whatnot. 2% is Indian, and about 8.9 or 9% is white and colored.
Thanks, Nazreen. That was very important to say that. Yes?
The folks from South Africa that have come more recently. When I was in South Africa, folks talked a lot about the brain drain. That people wanting to leave South Africa, professional people wanting to leave because of the crime. And
well, yeah.
They had to live in secured areas with fences and private guards. And
yeah.
Well, that became oppressive to some people. So a lot of them wanted to immigrate to other countries because of that. So I was wondering if you could speak to that brain drain that they talked about.
That is true. There was, and probably still is, this thing going on because when apartheid first started, many of the jobs that white officials or whoever had were given to black folks, and there came a point where the white university-educated boys couldn't find jobs. And so many of them went to Australia, New Zealand. Apparently, there is a hospital in New Zealand where Afrikaans is the major language being spoken between the nurses and the doctors. Can you believe that? And maybe you can't, but nevertheless, that's what I heard. And lots of them in Australia, many, many to Canada, many over here, many people have left to go to places where they can use their expertise. Any other question? You know, the first thing you need to do, of course, would be to get in contact with the South African, embassy, right, or the consulate. Probably the embassy closest to you, which would be in one of your larger cities. Consulate can help too, which will be closer in smaller cities. You will be talking to them, and they will be able, I hope, they'll be able to direct you. Now, there's also a place called Soweto, which I haven't mentioned, and that is near to Johannesburg. It's a place where many of the mine workers work and live, although some of them live in dormitories. And the standard of living in Soweto is still very low. Many people they will go into town to clean people's homes and so on. So the income that they have is not very high. And they live in Soweto, which is not, you will visit it if you visit there, because Nelson Mandela had lived there for a while. And there are also some very beautiful homes in the Soweto area around there. But most of it doesn't look so good. And I want to mention that to you because of the differences. So many of the people from north of South Africa come down to come and work in the mines, just like we see here, in a way. And you have all sorts of people. They don't always know who they are and where, but many of them end up in Soweto. Any?
Uh-huh. Is the government of South Africa a representative?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Do they have representatives from the different areas?
Yes. Yes, they do. They absolutely do. And somehow all of these are, some of them are down in Cape Town in Parliament, and some of them are over in Pretoria, and some in Bloemfontein.
There's representatives of all the areas?
Yes, yes, yes. And Bloemfontein is the legal capital. And Parliament is in Cape Town, and I think financial things are up in Pretoria, something like that. Any other question? Well, folks, there's lots of yummies to eat back there. I don't know how much is left. Feel free to help yourselves.
Before you do that, though, just let's give a round of applause to Renee.
Thank you.
This was fascinating, interesting. Thank you for infusing I asked her to, you know, just summarize the history of South Africa in, you know, a short half hour. Can you do that, please? So I thought that, you know, you did a beautiful job giving us a lot of information. And part of this program is a chance to intermingle and talk amongst yourselves. So we're not closing the doors. That's why we have food out and coffee and tea. Please, you know, congregate, meet each other, talk. And there's also, if you want more information, some books. And Nazarene even brought that beautiful
tablecloth. It's
batik.
Yeah, tablecloth. Yeah,
yeah. And I want to give you your certificate.
Oh, well, thank you.
And, you know, the carnivore shop doesn't have gift certificates. So I went to the next best thing, chocolate, and got you a gift certificate at Kilwins.
Thank you.
I got you a gift card there. Chocolate's good.
Oh, always.
Yes. But thank you all for coming, and thank you, Sister Cities Library. Please talk amongst yourselves and enjoy the food that everyone brought.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.